Ah, yes. The Thinking Man's Final Fantasy. The Crystal Pepsi of Final Fantasy. Level ups? Old. Individual stat ups? Bold. A cast of unnamed nobodies? Weak. A cast of named nobodies? Peak. See, I grew up in the early days of internet criticism. I was a young teen when AVGN's generation were making names for themselves. But while there were plenty of great comedic reviewers at the time, I remember being distinctly frustrated at the small number of, well, real serious reviewers that had any level of quality control. They existed, they just took a long time to gain any kind of mainstream traction. And because this is a slippery slope, let me clarify what I mean. I'm not saying that there weren't enough objective, enlightened reviewers that aligned with my particular perspective, which is what a lot of people mean when they complain about this. I mean, there was a lack of serious-minded analysis of the medium as a legitimate art form, and a lack of reviewers using evidence and examples to back up their claims. I made symbolism videos in my reviews specifically because I didn't think there was enough straight-faced analysis of games as their own emergent art form that can't be analyzed quite the same way as literature or film. I still inject humor into my work, but that's to keep things entertaining, not to make my analysis seem like a joke. I promise we're getting to Final Fantasy II in a sec, just bear with me, okay? I recently watched my friend and contemporary Libroscope make a 4-hour-long deep dive into Final Fantasy XIII and its critical reception. It's a genuinely provocative video that challenged my perspective on the game's mechanics. I still don't like the game, but I finally understand why some people do, which I legitimately thought would never happen. Certain games simply have a reputation that precedes them, and sometimes this can be so extreme that it blinds us to the other side of its quality. It's like how certain FromSoft fans can't even entertain the slightest criticism of their sacred cow. Conversely, some people can't entertain the possibility of someone actually enjoying Final Fantasy XIII, or today's subject, Final Fantasy II. I don't normally let mainstream criticism color my perception of a game so much. I like experiencing things for myself, that's just how I am. But Final Fantasy II was a rare exception. The perspective on this game was so overwhelmingly negative that it was hard to imagine all this consensus being wrong. However, Libroscope changing my perception of 13 has challenged my views on games with notorious reputation. So, I think I'd prefer to dive in and give it a try myself. And how do I feel about it? Well, I mean, you gotta watch the video to find out. Silly. I'll be playing the PlayStation 1 port, Final Fantasy Origins. I've owned a used copy since my third year of college, but I always played the first game without ever bothering with the second. The recent pixel remasters are great and all, but I just prefer the aesthetic of this version. And this edition is more, you know, accessible. If you want the most bang out of your buck, the PSP and GBA versions have bonus content the other versions lack. They also have some minor rebalances that are mostly for the better, but the versions are largely the same across the various editions. But I started playing the PS1 version, so that's what I'm reviewing. Final Fantasy II begins in the middle of a chaotic invasion. We follow our four young heroes-to-be as they try to desperately escape the Palamecian army. Emperor Madius is convorted with otherworldly monsters with aims to conquer all of the known world. He slaughters the majority of the townsfolk, including the families of our four childhood friends. The natural-born leader Firion, the gentle and simple-minded Gus, the kind-hearted Maria, and her courageous brother Leon. I may or may not be embellishing those personalities a bit because this isn't a super well-developed cast. As you can see, this version of the game opens up with an action-packed CG cutscene that still holds up pretty well. These visuals are right up there with Final Fantasy IX cinematics, and they're probably some of the best on PlayStation 1. After the opening, our heroes get surrounded by Palamecian forces and we enter a battle that we're guaranteed to lose. This is probably one of the earliest examples of a fight that the player is intended to lose, and it certainly won't be the last time the series makes use of this trope. Looking at you, lady. Starting out with a loss may seem discouraging, but that's kind of the point. It sets the tone the game is going for right off the bat. Beginning the game with a hopeless scenario conveys that the odds are against the player from the very beginning. I won't spoil how bad things get, but let's just say this game has one hell of a body count. Storytelling this elaborate and tragic was unthinkable back in 1988 when the NES original debuted. It doesn't hold a candle to the storytelling of later Final Fantasies, but for the time, it was genuinely revolutionary. This dark tone extends to the visual and audio direction as well. Shortly after our defeat at the hands of the Emperor's men, we hear the Rebel Army theme. It's hopeful, yet solemn in a way. It's a bittersweet anthem for the last hope for peaceful days returning to a war-torn world. This soundtrack is one of Nobuo Uematsu's best works. Even if you don't end up checking out the game itself, I highly recommend looking up the OST. You won't regret it. In particular, the Pixel Remasters brought back Uematsu to compose some truly masterful orchestrations. The emotional potency of these tracks can't be overstated. I genuinely think that some of the man's best work is here, and that's saying a lot. If you want to avoid spoilers for the final dungeon's aesthetics, skip ahead to the time on screen. But every version of the last dungeon theme, Pandemonium, is downright haunting. It feels chaotic, yet deliberate in its execution. As I traveled through this beautifully bizarre landscape, the music made me feel like this was truly the culmination of the journey. And given how brutal this game's difficulty curve was, it felt like the end of a truly epic challenge that takes real effort to overcome. I also appreciate the variety of dungeon themes. It's not just the same track over and over for each area. The game rotates a few distinct tracks to keep things fresh. I gotta give props to the music, because honestly, it's one of the few positives most people will agree on. But before we get to the progression system, I also gotta praise the pixel art. The color scheme of the Origins Edition manages to feel appropriately dour without feeling boring or repetitive. Caves tend to have different color palettes from each other, same with castles and fortresses. I could distinguish between every area in the game from just a screenshot. Apart from maybe some villages that use the same tile set. The remakes have some incredible art direction that makes each place a joy to explore. At least, visually. Okay, I think we've delayed the inevitable as much as we can. Let's talk about gameplay. Final Fantasy II is an old game. One of the oldest I've reviewed aside from the OG Dragon Quest. NES games are just a little too far back for my taste most of the time, so I'd rather play remakes and remasters when available. This is particularly true for RPGs. I find that the mechanics and balancing of 80s RPGs tend to age like milk left out in the sun that someone puked in. I'm really glad that remakes exist for a lot of these games, is what I'm trying to say. But in the case of Final Fantasy II, a lot of the archaic, esoteric nonsense is still here, barely altered from the original release. The Origins version is more accessible than the NES original, but that's not saying much. It's still got some of that old-school difficulty that'll knock your block off if you go in unprepared. Notably, the version of Final Fantasy I on the disc allows you to select between easy and normal difficulty right from the get-go, with easy being much more noob-friendly. With Final Fantasy II, you have no choice but to play on easy. If you beat the game, if you prove yourself, then you can attempt the normal difficulty. This is a simple difference, but it speaks volumes. Square knew that II was alienating, both for its difficulty, but also for its fundamental mechanics. This is a weird game, but I went into it wanting to give it a fair shot. Here's the two big questions. How much do you need to grind? And what does that grinding entail? Oh boy. If you've already watched a million videos on Final Fantasy II, bear with me, but we need to make sure everyone is on the same page. So, progression in this game is very unique. Let's go with that. You don't gain levels in Final Fantasy II, nor do you gain any EXP from battles. Instead, your characters steadily get better at what they do most. The more you attack, the faster your character's strength increases. The more you use a weapon or shield, the stronger your attacks get with that kind of weapon, and the better you get at evading enemy attacks, respectively. The more you get hit by a certain type of damage, the more durable you become against that type of damage, etc. Think something like Elder Scrolls skill progression. Some would say that this system is ahead of its time, and some would say this is reinventing a wheel that was doing just fine as it was. As for how I feel about it, I think it's a neat idea with some extremely questionable execution. If the numbers involved had been better balanced, I probably would have a much more favorable opinion, but as it stands, well, let's break it down. Magic is probably the most egregious part of this system. To grow a spell from level 1 to level 2, you need to cast it at least 50 times. Most of the time, physical attacks are the more efficient way to dispatch enemies, so you kinda have to go out of your way to grind magic to make it useful. Magic is mostly useful against bosses and a specific type of enemy called Flans, who have obscenely high physical defense. But it's worth noting that Fists and the Blood Sword do good damage against most bosses anyway. So if you're trying to minimize grinding, you can be like me and not use magic for damage at all. What about the Flans? Exactly. What about the Flans? They have a low agility stat, so you can flee those battles very easily. The game probably would have been easier if I had grinded my spells up, but when I play JRPGs, especially old ones, I stubbornly try to see how little grinding I can get away with. I feel like I understand the game's balancing a lot better when I'm not just overpowering every single enemy I come across and getting my stats up to the max. And I managed to beat this game with only my cure spell breaching the level 3 threshold. It was about level 7 on my best cure spell user, out of a possible 16. So I dodged the grinding bullet as far as magic is concerned. So what's the problem? Well, I still had to grind. And grinding in this game isn't as simple as other Final Fantasies, because there's no EXP, remember? You need to perform or survive certain actions to get your stats up. For a good while, I made do with just fighting like normal. But eventually, I hit a wall. These walls, to be exact. These guys could kill most of my party members with a single attack, and that was a problem because they were a common encounter, not a boss fight. I needed to use spells to buff myself in order to survive these attacks, but buff spells have a high chance to miss until you grind them up a few levels. Yes, spells like Shield, Shell, and Blink can miss. Everything requires grinding to be useful. After I hit this wall, I really started to struggle and stopped enjoying the ride, and I was enjoying it until then. There's innovation, and then there's being different for the sake of being different. There is no justifying having self-buffs miss. Not every spell should demand mandatory grinding to just become vaguely usable, but that's not the part that really blew my mind. You want to know the only reliable way to increase your HP in this game? Attacking yourself. I am gaining stats at an incredible rate by attacking myself. I made more progress in 20 minutes of punching myself in the face than hours of conventional battle. As far as I can tell, the game genuinely expects this of me. I cracked the code. The code lay bare before me. And it was an ugly, ugly sight. Both mechanically and narratively, it's the last thing anyone would naturally think to do. Stopping the momentum of the game to beat yourself senseless until members hit a minimum requirement isn't fun. And yes, I could have equipped 2 shields and hit myself to increase my evasion instead, but that's just a different form of the same problem. This aspect of the game is not only incredibly unintuitive, it's just plain boring. And unless you have a tolerance for grinding, or you're just really invested in experiencing the history of video games, I can't recommend Final Fantasy II to the average player these days, largely because of this convoluted, monotonous grind. And you know what the worst part is? All of this whining is rendered largely irrelevant, because later versions make it easier to increase your stats in normal battles. Meaning that I've wasted your time, and more importantly, my time. However, it can still take a lot of effort to get your stats up even in the more recent releases. So no matter what, you have to deal with a grind in one form or another. But if you can deal with that stuff, is the game worth it? Well, maybe? If you are the type who's curious about Final Fantasy's history, the atmosphere and tone of the game is really impressive for its time. In particular, I admire how dynamic the dialogue for NPCs is. It's not much compared to the average PS1 title, let alone games today. But knowing that the original debuted in 88 means it would have been revolutionary at the time. And indeed, the game received a lot of praise when it first released. Looking back at its contemporaries, it's easy to see why. NPCs, even minor ones, constantly update their dialogue depending on recent story events. When towns get destroyed and civilians are killed or rescued by the player, the townsfolk and people at the HQ actually react. There's also a somewhat controversial keyword system that allows for more dynamic conversations with other characters. You can memorize certain words or phrases and ask about these topics in conversation with important characters. It's kind of like something you'd see in a point-and-click adventure. Sometimes you need to throw out a particular keyword at the right character in order to proceed. It might feel like annoying busy work, and that's because it kind of is. Some may say that this encourages people to pay more attention to the dialogue and world-building, but quality writing shouldn't have to rely on a mandatory gimmick like this in order to be engaging. My guy, Styles, summed it up well in his review. The people who don't care about the story are just gonna resent being forced to deal with this system to progress. It's not a terrible idea or anything, I kinda like it in fact, but there's a reason it didn't return in future games. It simply doesn't lend much to the experience, and occasionally makes progression just a bit more annoying to figure out. As is the case with many games of this era, the dungeons are basically just mazes with the encounter rate set way too high. But there is one little feature that makes these labyrinths particularly sadistic. Trap rooms. Doors that lead to completely empty rooms, with encounter rates so high that you get into a battle on both of the steps it takes to exit them. And yes, it really does warp you into the center of the room, just so you have to get into a battle or two to escape. Even considered against the sadistic dungeon design of the time, this is just needlessly cruel, and every dungeon in the game has these rooms. Did a programmer just wake up on the wrong side of the bed every day during this game's development or something? Like, just why? So, with all this in mind, should you play this game for yourself? Well, if you're not super curious about the history of one of gaming's biggest franchises, it can be a tough sell. Its progression system is convoluted. If you hit a difficulty wall, the solution usually just amounts to grinding, and it has some downright asshole-ish design. I'd recommend playing this game on a platform that allows for save states, because losing progress can be absolutely brutal. That all being said, it's nowhere near as bad as the reviewers I watched growing up made it out to be. You have to grind, but not any more than the average game of the time. Due to the unorthodox character progression system, it varies how much time it takes to progress. And even in the PS1 version, I only really had to hit myself for HP gains. Every other stat increased in normal battles. Combine this with the stellar pixel art and music in the remakes, Final Fantasy II is a lot better than the internet made me think it was. But it is a flawed game that demands a lot of your time for how simple the payoff ultimately is. Either way, I'm glad I finally gave the game a shot. I had a mostly good time with it, despite my complaints, and it's a piece of gaming history I'm glad to have under my belt. I feel like I understand the history of my favorite genre a little bit better now. It must have felt truly mind-blowing in Japan at the time of its release. And in some ways, I can definitely see why. If you're curious, give it a go. Come to your own conclusion, and then come here and let me know what you think, because I actually do read every comment I get. And I'm interested to hear what y'all have to say on this flawed but ambitious classic. But hey, thanks as always for watching. I plan on reviewing a lot of JRPGs in the future, so I hope y'all look forward to it. If you like what I do, leaving a like, commenting, and sharing is always appreciated. And subscribing, that's cool too. And if you really like my work, consider supporting me directly on Patreon like these awesome people, or giving a one-time donation with the links below. People like this are basically the only reason I'm alive. So until next time, stay safe out there, nerds.